Namaste. I welcome you all for this talk on Stambha, when the moment ceases to move and the space ceases to exist. I warmly appreciate the effort taken by Sri Mudralaya's team, the Natya Amrita Manthan, and its inception in 2020, that too during this lockdown period, to take an initiative so that they could organize a very beautiful seminar on Stambha. The word generally means a pillar, but in the spoken language of Sanskrit, it could also mean a post, a column, suppression, stoppage, inflation, many more shades of meaning to it. Lexicon also lends a kind of a meaning, something to do with stupidity, insensibility, stupefaction, fear, out of joy, out of grief, coldness, suppression of faculty, hindrance. But there's a term called sthambhaka, which also means arresting. It also has a link of something getting established firmly on something. What kind of stillness are we discussing here? Is it the stillness of someone who is very lethargic? Is every stillness worth mulling over? The stillness of a rainbow body of a Tibetan monk, the stillness of a stone balancing artist who balances stone upon stone so delicately, that too on the presence of nature, on a flowing water, the stillness of Anne Frank's poem during the most disturbing time of World War, she could find her space to write her column, her poems. The stillness of Marina Abramovic, an artist who could perform stillness as a performance, who could just sit for hours together or stand and be a witness to human response. The stillness of Pablo Picasso's painting, Guernica, where the canvas is just still. It speaks about heavy, dense violence of the World War. What kind of stillness are we speaking about? I wish to invite Sri Aurobindo on this matter. He states, here, to understand Indian art, the only right way is to get at once through a total intuitive or revelatory impressions or by some meditative dwelling on the whole dhyana, in the technical term, to the spiritual meaning and atmosphere, make ourselves one with that as completely as possible. And then only the helpful meaning and value of all the rest comes out with a complete and revealing force. For here in Indian art, it is the spirit that carries the form. It's not the other carrying the spirit. This kind of gives us an idea of stillness of the Buddha or of Dakshinamurti. Actually, the dhyana, the kind of wholeness what Sri Aurobindo is speaking, is something to do with memory. The hardwired nature of human memory. Memory is not just to do with the current brain function, but it has hardwired memory of all the beings' existence, all the past evolution, all the past cognition embedded in it. Actually, if human stands as the tallest embodiment of evolution chain, then human is the standing altar where memory gets encrusted, one on top of the other. Human, in principle, human memory has all the memories of a snake, which is a Chaturendriya Jiva, or a Panchendriya Jiva, like a mammal, or a five sensory organ, or even organs with one sensory organ, or which we call as Ekendriya Jivas. Actually, human being is a Shadendriya Jiva, or he has six sensory organs. Memory actually is anadi. Memory is apurusheya, which means memory does not have a source at the end. Adi antam, it doesn't have anadi, or memory is independent of adi and anta. And memory is apurusheya, independent of human existence. Memory is more or less like Veda. It is something which is visible in a completely different eye through a drishta, drishtantara. That's why who wrote Veda mantras are called drishtaks, drishta. It's paralokic in nature. What is paraloka? Paraloka is not something, a vertical alignment of a world. Rather, it's a world of memory where every being in that loka are denuded beings. They actually don't have bodies. They don't have embodied. They're disembodied beings. They are like illumined seeds hanging on everywhere. Memory is stasis. Time and space doesn't move there. Memory is self-illumined. Memory is the Veda. It stacks itself heavily, one on top of the other. That's why it's called a stambha. Memory is stambha. Any human memory has to descend down from the disembodied realm to the embodied realm of a human sthula sharira. From the sukshma sharira, it has descend down to the sthula level. Actually, to do every act, something invisible has to become visible. To make something invisible visible is what is called as creating an image or imagination. A classic example we take is about a seed sprouting. It has a memory of growth in it. Now, slowly when moisture gets in contact with seed, it sprouts. Suddenly we see the roots are growing, but the shoot literally is very juvenile. It doesn't even grow. In due course, that which is visible, the root, gets into the soil. That which was visible to us becomes invisible into the soil and establishes its roots down more and more. So that which was invisible, the shoot, suddenly becomes visible. It becomes more conspicuous. It's talking to us every day. The shoot is talking to us, but the root is completely sunk. That the more the root becomes invisible, the more shoot becomes visible. This is what is the inversion of invisible to visible. And this is a human act. Every act has the memory, the stambha has to go into deeper, deeper roots and get invisible so that the act, the deed, can be visible to us. Actually, at this particular moment, when something is transient at this particular moment, suddenly, when the visible becomes very conspicuous, the transit between the known and the unknown, or the punctuation between the known and the unknown, actually becomes very ambiguous and fragile. It breaks. Suddenly there is a cessation, and it's a flow between the known and the unknown. From the unknown, the known is suddenly revealed. And there's a gush of ocean of information gushing into it. Such an experience, fostered by the memory initially, which was actually visible, slowly rooting itself into the soil and allowing the shoot of knowledge to grow. This gush of exchange, where something is actually suddenly descending down, is like a gush of an ocean. That's why knowledge is called an ocean. We generally call it as Ratnakara. Discussion is on Sangeeta. That entire discussion is called Sangeeta Ratnakara, which is actually as its originary forces in the memory or the stambha. If it's on Natya, it's Natya Ratnakara. Or if it's on Sahitya, the text, it's called Sahitya Ratnakara. Or it also means Arnava. Arnava is ocean, Bharata Arnava. Many texts are named after such things, the familiarity with ocean. Actually, when that particular transit happens, a very crucial thing happens is that the cognition of synchronic duration and aspatial location. Knowledge is revealed to us only in a kshana, only in a kshetra. So what? How do we define kshana? How do you define kshetra? How do we understand them? Actually, memory comes into place. The stambha comes into place here. We take an example of a ball. When the ball is moving from one end to the other, the idea of rolling is located in the ball till it rolls and stops. Actually, the act of rolling is located into the ball. It's a quality. It's like a, on a simpler term, it's a verb. Now, how do we find the location of that verb? It's like finding quality of ourselves into our human body. Can we locate it? It is not. But it is actually located within ourselves without any physical tangible material. Like the way Manas is located. Such a non-spatial location is called aspatial location. Such a location technically is called Kshetra. And the time duration to which this particular location, that particular quality is inherited or located within that entity without any disturbance for a continuous duration. The smallest duration to which there is no disturbance, there is no change in the status quo is called kshana. It's called synchronic duration, which means generally, how do we perceive time? Time is perceived by change. If something doesn't change, does the time exist? Actually not. The only way we could perceive time is, we don't have a special sensory organ to perceive time. Eyes cannot perceive time. It can only see. Ears has sound, but there's no sensory organ special to perceive time only by change. And if there's no change around us, time doesn't move. Henceforth, the entire duration seems to be one. It's called kshana. Kshana is that duration where an entire quality or a kind of a locus is located in a sense. At that particular moment, that kshana, at that kshetra, an aspatial location, suddenly the transit between the known and the unknown happens, entirely based on the support of memory or dhyana. Which starts like a solid stambha descending from the paraloka into the ihaloka or the human body or human senses. This would later lead to cognition, and in turn it would lead to imagination and henceforth action. In fact, this act through which we are talking, we would call in Tamil called urayadal, vaadadal, poradal, neeradal. In Telugu, it's called matalaadu, porata, neerata. In Kannada, we can have chellata, bombeata. See, actually, suddenly we see in Malayalam, we have a term like kaliyatam or a pandatam. You know, every act, hence, whatever we have been discussing so far, suddenly we realize something is happening. Body is trying to cognize it. In a very spatio-temporally extended human body is trying to cognize it. Then we are asking to a deed, name to that deed as Urai. Or suddenly, to it. In society, in societal parlance, most of the verb ends with in a continuous sentence, especially in the four Dravidian language, with a word called adal, atam, ata. Generally, it is called as games or sports. Of course, it is to do with existential verb in a society. But when it comes to games, it is called as, it has the same term. Games and sports has the same term called atam, adal. Interestingly, martial arts, dance and theater also has the same term. The place where such thing happens, and all these verbs are called adu kalam, and place where it happens through unit of transition is called adavu. And the place where this entire atom is happening is trying to gather knowledge. It's trying to exchange and trying to capture through the presence of memory. Atom is about, all the atom we discussed is about dealing with irrationals. The reality right in front of us is absolutely unfathomable. They are like bundles of irrationals. We are trying to figure it out. But how do we figure it out? Irrationals are also called as surds. In Persian, the word surd, surd, means people who don't have ears, or literally people who don't listen to you. Reality is a surd. It's also called surd, from which the word sard also comes. Some people interpret that to be sardar, who doesn't listen to anyone. Sardars are leaders. A French scientist, Ferdinand von Lindemann, in 1882, wrote a paper that it's impossible to square a circle. Actually, this is because if you want to construct a circle, a square of the same area of a circle, of an already predetermined circle, we would not be able to exactly create equivalent circle because we can't find the square root of pi. How do we resolve this? Squaring a circle is a challenge. Now, man engages himself in finding this solution. He invites the deposited memory, the stumper. Now, this descent, the Greeks have investigated through one of the greatest thinkers called Euclid. In his Elements, he discussed this. And he says, we can rationalize the irrational by an idea called reasoning or in ratio. In ratio is what the mean. The word ratio means reasoning. We have to reason one is to the other. The famous thing of Euclid is fire as to air is as to air is to water. Whereas air is to water is to earth. This is called finding the known to the unknown in terms of ratio. And that ratio-nating, reasoning, is what is the idea of co-measuring, ratio. And that is called the idea of danda. Idea of a danda, a measure. Now, the same problem, Indic thinkers, like Badrayana, Katyayana, Apastamba, Manava, they have written a text called Shulva Sutra. The word Shulva means a rope. We want to square a circle? Practically impossible in mathematics, yes. But through a rope, it is achievable. There's a rope measurement they bring in and they try to. It's very Vedic in nature. Actually, in a very simple term, to square, squaring a circle, converting a circle to a square, which are literally irrational. Reality is like that. You can't fathom it so soon. Now you have to invite the memory and try to find out a small speck of measure, a dandam. In fact, this is constantly reasoning between two worlds. Because why is so critical about squaring a circle? Because in Vedic science, a square represents the earth and circle represents the heaven. As it is on heaven, on earth as it is on heaven, is one of the prayers from the Bible. The entire effort is to bring the heaven to earth, bring the circle to the square. How do you do that? Practically impossible. You need a danda. You need the help of memory, stambha, to create a danda, a sense of ratio, a sense of rope. Practically, when it comes to art, one of the earliest artisan thinker, you know, mythical thinkers, or kind of scientists in their own realm, are Vishwakarmans. The first installation they made was installing a flagpole on the square platform. That's called the Dvajastambha. It is a connecting element between the circle and the square. We need a danda, an extended ratio, an extended rope, an extended measure, so that we can ratiocinate reality. Actually, this is what everyone does. This saduram, becoming a circle, mandala, is you need a danda in between. When it comes to martial art, this is done through a stick called the vadi. When it comes to dance, this is done through most of it. It is done, it is as if drawing circles over square. There's a square base on which we draw circular patterns on top of it. Now this is typically called as sadir, chaturam, chatura, chaduru in Telugu, square, on vidukattudal in Tamil. But with the help of a danda, a spine. Spine is a reasoning factor with its intelligentsia descending down, exactly aligned with the cognition of the universal stambha. Suddenly something very deep is revealed. And such an act is called silambam. That's why practicing dance, acting, theater, it's called silamba kudam. Interestingly, in one of the ancient Cambodian inscriptions, there's a term called silpakar, silambakar, which means a magician who acts. Any magician would need a wand, and that is danda, which is stacking memory. To do an artam, to do an artam, ardal, arta, or whatever we discussed, is to measure the irrational. At that level, whatever was external, the artam was external in terms of games and sports, had to transit inward and make an en route called an art. The art of gaming, the art of sports, the art of martial, the art of dancing, and the art of acting, the art of performance, the art of singing. Suddenly, whatever got registered, accumulated as knowledge can be displayed as either as a visual art or as a performing art. The visual art is called as synchronic art, and performing art is generally is called as diachronic art. The term chronos means time. Synchronos, the entire work of art is available to us in one instance. In diachronic art, the entire work of art is available over a period of time. What is so interesting about synchronic art? For example, painting, a sculpture, or a pottery, or an architecture, is that its exteriors are static, while the interiors are constantly in motion. About diachronic art, over a period of time, as if the frames and frames of events are moving over time, while the interiors are absolutely static. Now, wherever the point stasis is there, it is directly linked to the memory, the frame of memory, the danda, the stambha. Now, when it comes to synchronic art, how does we make sense of a painting? Nothing is moving there. It's a collection of patches, pigments, strokes, and marks on a canvas or on a wall. Now, suddenly, we understand that a painting is very thick, it's very fat. It's between the viewer and the receding horizon. It's so thick. It's not two-dimensional. Actually, in that space, a line unfolds itself into a plane. A plane unfolds or throws into a volume. A volume doubles itself into something else. Now, this thick space, which is far more deeper, is because the interiors are in motion. The exterior is static. Only the interior's movements are constantly revealing something to us. In terms of sculpture, the exteriors are solid. We can't get into a sculpture. Getting into a sculpture is difficult. Because sculpture is more or less, it can be defined, it's not sculpting the material, rather sculpting the ambience. A sculpture is a sculpture in many ways because of the fall of light and shade on it, which defines its interiors. Actually, the interiors of a sculpture is not so anything. It's just dull. It's just lifeless. The exteriors, the ambience is getting sculpted. Actually, the exteriors are static, but there is a very invisible interiors which are constantly moving and giving us meaning. There's something called life in a sculpture that comes out of this constant inner motion. It's very difficult to get out of a constant motion, infinite motions within a painting. It's actually difficult to get into a sculpture. But it is resolved through an architecture. In architecture, there's an idea of entrance, a dwara, entry and exit point. It is in one way carries the points of a painting, it also carries the point of a sculpture. A classic example where an architecture and a sculpture kind of meets is the Statue of Liberty. Most of us know the interior is an architecture, while the exterior is a sculpture. It has a dwara. Now, this idea of sculpture inviting light into it becomes architecture. Because yesteryear's construction of a home, a residence, is not actually constructing a dwelling point for us. If I construct a house, I don't construct a house for me. I construct a house for my ancestors. In my lifetime, my ancestors are the empty courtyard, which they form a square. That square grid, which I keep empty in my center of the home, in the older residential architecture, is like the column of light, the column of memory, the column of stambha, the column of actually descending higher forces down. We are inviting a higher memory into a lower residential architecture to reside there. We worshipfully live around it. When we construct a house, we can't live in that house. We invite our ancestors to live in the house. When I leave this world, I live in the center of the house. Actually, the center house, the house is called Nadu Veedu in Tamil. The center of the house is always given to the higher divine forces and the ancestors to stay. And they are generally symbolized with an empty space as if or with pillars at home. They have entrances, they have windows. Now, coming to diachronic art, music is an equivalent to painting. Actually, music and painting has direct connections, and many a times music is graphical in nature. A genre of painting called Ragamala painting is a direct example where the memory, when is sent through over time, is called music. But the same memory, when displayed over a restricted, enclosed material, becomes painting. when it's sculpture, something very interesting is the memory of a sculptor, which is over an enclosed material, the same set of memory when it done over time is what is called as dance. Actually, dance is about sculpting the ambience. When we move on a stage, it's we as a human, as a dancing body, the body is perceived to be moved, but actual what is moving is the space around. There is a contraction and relaxation of the space with each other. It gives an impression as if someone is moving. Movement is defined not with respect to the body, but with respect to the ambience around. It is very difficult to get into a body of a dancer. Actually, there's nothing inside a dancer's body. Something can constantly keep happening on the dancer's body, but externally dance can happen. This is very similar to the idea of a sculpture. The memory part, the stambha part, is the stambha shared over space by a sculptor, over time by a dancer, is same. Likewise, the stambha, the memory stored by an architect, inviting higher forces into it, and a natya, one who creates a natya, a drama, a theater, is exactly the same. It has an idea of entrance to it. You can enter into a work of a narrative, of a natya, of a theater. You can exit out of it mentally and keep shuttling in and out of the work. Understand until in a sculpture, when I want to draw your attention, that in a sculpture, as it's difficult to enter into a sculpture, unrest and until the sculptor has made a conscious effort to invite the people to get into, drawn into a sculptor. So is a dancer. Unless and until a dancer makes a conscious effort to draw the audience into their work of art, audience cannot be drawn into dance so easily. A dancer can absolutely be in their own realm and keep moving around. Unlike in a theater, that the moment we start watching a theater work, we start entering into it and start participating with it, as if our memories are descending down and we start matching it with all the experiences of the past for us. This entire experience of synchronic and diachronic arts, something very strange is the idea of memory which the work of art, the artist is endowed with, the idea of stambha to which they hold themselves, and they look at the world as a flowing water. Sitting in the banks of life, watching life and recreating life with available material on the banks, with trying to create a small house out of the sands in the banks of a river. Actually watching the real house in the flowing ocean, in the flowing rivers. But the question is, how do you create that? The artist is asked to first sit, to take an asana, the asana of truth. Before saying the truth, take a stance. And that is erected physically by the danda, the vajra danda, or also called as vamsha danda. The word vamsha danda means the spinal cord. Vajra danda also means the spinal cord, the descent of the stambha, the descent of memory on a human body. You sit, take an asana, take a stance, a memory stance, from which something truthful can come out. Doing abhinaya in front of a greatest of the forces, one is expected to sit, take an asana, and say the truth. Even the ruler may not know about it. The gods may not know about it. But it entirely rests on the shoulders of the actor, a dancer, to say the truth. When someone sits, the body becomes the danda itself. The spine within the body is another danda. So there's a danda within the danda within the danda. Question is, a sitting body, a squatting body in an asana is exactly connecting a square to a circle. The circle is actually squared now. mathematically, which is irresolvable, is resolved artistically. There is no other way to do this. For this, the only support or the only modus operandi is memory, the main stamba, and a co-measured memory called the danda. Now, at this particular thing, at this particular instance, the stamba can speak the highest truth. It can flow through the body and speak the highest possible truth, which the body itself is not cognitive enough. There is no need for the body to know the entire truth, what it's speaking, but the audience might get it. There is a possibility. Because not all what the artist carries, the artist need to know. At times, the arrangement, the information the body carries, it can be reflective and left for the audience. Now, this kind of submission of truth is a very artificial, it's artifice, it's an artificial setup through which it's completely removed from nature. Still, it's revealing truth. This is called dharma. Actually, this pipeline, the empty hollow pipeline, which is central plumb line through which something is very, very transparent is flowing, is where is called the pipeline of dharma, the pipeline of aram, on which all the grammars of art is built. Now, this is a kind of a measurement. Someone is ruminating and measuring this metrics through artam. So basically, artam is done to measure the unfathomed reality and say the strangest truth about it. But that's why the greatest of the measurer is called Adal Vallan. Actually, the term Adal Vallan means the greatest of the measurers, the greatest of the rationalist who's trying to square a circle constantly. And he's trying to make the most private enterprise plural in witness. The witness, many people can witness this. For this, he has to make his body hollow. Interestingly, the word Adal Vallan also means measure of time, measure of space, measure of weight. In Chola period, length is weight is called Adal Vallan. Yeah, Adal Vallan is a measure during Rajarajan's period. At this instance, the word, his pada, the memory, the stambha, which is descended down, is bending itself into various patterns. The stambha is also called as yupa, yashti, janma, from which origin of many things comes out. It is also called as charana, also called as pada, also called as mahapurusha, also called as angri. Now, actually, when it is curving itself to say the truth, it is called kunchita pada, kunchita charana, kunchita angri, the bend of the memory stambha, the curving of the memory stambha, to liberate ourselves from the mundane clutches to highest truth, this bending has to happen. And that is the only point of liberation. The kunchita pada, kunchita angri, kunchita charana is the point of liberation. As an artist, as a dancer, the highest form of dance, being in the body to liberate the body. To liberate the body, body is constantly kept in a spin. The dance of a dervish, where the skirts are flowing away. From the top view, we see as if there's a circle around, and in the center, there's a body which is constantly spinning in an axis. what is spinning around across the... Suddenly we see the entire cosmos is spinning around the body. Slowly the body is forgetting its physical clothing. Flesh is forgotten. After hours and hours of spinning, out of excessive exhaustion and pain the body has undergone, it slowly forgets the body. The physical gravitas of the body is forgotten. And what is revealed is the hollowness of the body, where the khud, the self, is submitted to the khudai, the god. And what is left over is inner spine, or called the vamshadanda, encased in a conduit called stambha, or memory. Memory of infinite, eternal imprints of all the lives and all the non-lives, all the sentient and all the insentient, suddenly cascades one and becomes just memory. At that moment, only memory exists. Nothing else exists. Everything ceases to exist. Stambha is a yearning point for any human being to attain. Rather, it is the source, the principle of origin and principle of ordering. And that ordering is what Veda calls as Ritam Satyam. With this note, I say Stambha is a point when time ceases to move and space ceases to expand. Thank you.